So seeing all the issues that you've talked about, do our colleges have enough infrastructure or staff to change entirely the mode of operation that is now being imposed?
The funny bit is that there is no quality insistence. So autonomy means that you will be given the freedom without insisting on infrastructure, whether you have the capacity to sustain new kinds of courses or increase student fees and take in more students or not, that the government is not looking into. Now, as far as the institutions are concerned, we are being showed some ways, like I told you, transform a part of the college premises, give them out for, coaching institutes, make your senior teachers do some corporate consultancy, MOOCs. Nandita mentioned MOOCs. Now, digital literacy and digital learning and all of that is, of course, we are very much embedded in that scenario, the whole teaching learning process. But, to replace physical classroom teaching learning with massive online courses where you don't need more classrooms, where more students can be enrolled through a virtual system, through virtual courses. But what is going to be the ultimate quality of those courses? We see that in the semester system, even our classroom teaching learning has suffered. Because, the courses are so badly modularized and students just don't get enough time to engage with the content that we give them. And, now the next step is, just not having physical contact with your students. Okay, so through reaching out to them through these virtual sort of modules. So quality is the last thing in the mind of the government. Quality is getting very severely undermined. All right, the whole point is that education is being seen as a kind of a market from where profits can be leveraged. Private players want several entry points into this market, and that's the entire vision. Unfortunately, education, in the real sense, lacks a vision as far as policymakers are concerned, and it lacks a leadership, because all these people, including the people in the ministry, the politicians, all of them are behaving, they are acting as go-betweens, brokers, between educational institutions and very powerful international lobbies that are pressurizing them through the WTO GATS, through the several multilateral trade treaties, of which higher education, unfortunately, has been pledged as a part by successive governments.
Yes, I just want to add a little bit to that, this MOOCs business. We don't have to sort of speculate that, of course, it's very clear to any person with a little bit of common sense that you can't really replace this formal classroom interaction of student and teacher with non-formal education. Non-formal education is for those who somehow cannot get to formal education. It's an additional thing, and it's not even the way in which IGNU and others, they operate. They implement their courses through people. They have a large number of employees in all their centers, and they actually administer all those courses. But the MOOCs system all over the world has failed very badly. It has been an absolute disaster in terms of teaching and learning. These have been evaluated over and over again. So it's a failed system which is being sought to be imposed on a third world country, right? The second thing is that, as you talked about these corporate lobbies, these international corporate lobbies, you see, even organizations like the WTO and other such organizations have been increasingly taken over by corporations. It's not just governments, the non-government players are playing a very big role everywhere. They are formulating government policy, they are lobbying, and they are making sure that the policies are implemented for their benefits, so that their profits can increase. So when they make very major financial mistakes, they're bailed out. And ordinary people are made to suffer. Government then imposes austerity measures, which means cut back on public health, cut back on public education, cut back on all welfare policies, so that ordinary people pay for the mistakes and the greed of the large corporations. That's happening all over the world. There is resistance also. Where there is greater resistance, you are able to protect your public education. All these governments, whether it was the UPA or it was the NDA, they have become puppets in the hands of these corporations, which are dictating policy. In 2005, the Indian government offered higher education as a commercial tradable service under GATS. Now, that was crazy. Why should higher education or any education become a trade?
Yeah, commodity.
See, because then you have all the logic of the trade the laws mm-hmm. which say that you cannot have unfair trade practices, you cannot give any incentives to your own domestic suppliers as compared to all the foreign players, and that means your subsidies go, and if your subsidies go, whether it is in agriculture or in education particularly, your education will not be accessible to most people, because then you'll have to recover the entire cost from the user, that is the student. Right.
Yeah.
And that is what will put it out of the reach of 95% of us, of our students.
Because students are such an important stakeholder in this entire scenario, they ought to know, and their parents who are spending the money ought to know, that, you know, the government is often talking about loans, education loans. And, you know, without knowing about it, it seems like an attractive or even viable kind of proposition. But, you know, the maximum number, I mean, United States had been privatizing its education system for a very long time. And the maximum number of student loans are taken in the United States. It's a way of also allowing the financial sector to come in very heavily into the education sector, right? And the debt crisis that happened in the United States a few years back, when people studied it, they realized that the largest component of that debt crisis was student loans. Students are either unable to pay back their loans, or, you know, they are in such a pressure to get to well-paying jobs, or, I mean, some kind of source of income that will allow them to pay back those loans in a very short period of time, that they are unable to take proper decisions in terms of their lives, their criticality and their ability to think independently, to use their education to sort of, act with a degree of independence is completely thwarted, because they fall into this debt trap. You know, any nation which is allowing its student population to fall into a debt trap at such a young age is a nation which I don't think that the leaders of the nation are really interested in building the nation up or empowering the youth of that nation. They're doing exactly the opposite of what they are claiming to do.
Employment is at an all-time low.
Yeah.
So you don't get employment to pay back the loan that you have taken for your education. You can see the disaster that is in the making, that this will completely destroy our country, the young of our country, which is after all the future.
Yeah. And on that note, I would end this discussion, and thanks a lot for joining me on this show. And that's all the time we have for News Click. Thank you.